Hello and welcome back to Touchline Talk. Here we have a very special episode with Kevin. Really pleased to get you on. Looking forward to having a good chat. And I think the special thing for me that we've both got in common at the moment is we're both located in sunny Spain. So I'm sure we'll have a lot of good experiences to share. And you know, we've both come at it from a bit of a different angle, but to share your experiences with the viewers, I think will be a really special experience for people to tune in and listen to.
Great, thank you for having me on, Simon. Great to be here and talking to you about what we love, right?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I just want to first of all just say thank you to you. I can remember in my first year when I come to Spain, you were someone that gave me some good advice, good feedback, and we had some good conversations about life here in Spain. And a lot of those conversations really gave me a lot of confidence. They gave me a lot of belief. I just want to say thank you to you just for giving up your time when I moved out here and just putting some of my worries at ease.
You're more than welcome. It was, I remember talking to you. I love talking about the game with anyone. And yeah, I remember it really vividly, exactly where I was actually the first time I spoke to you. And, you know, I think I'd just say congratulations to you because, you know, I've spoken to a lot of people since we moved out here 6 years ago, many of whom obviously haven't moved for whatever reason, haven't taken the plunge. Those who do, you know, it's not easy. There's one or two others who've done it and found a few roadblocks, and that's life, right? But then, you know, you've shown an awful lot of kind of grit and resilience and a willingness to kind of go out there and kind of walk the walk, not just talk the talk, and look where you are now. And, you know, congratulations to you.
No, I appreciate that. I do appreciate that. And obviously for yourself as well, you know, the experiences that you're gaining here and that you were able to give me as well, you know, I wouldn't be as confident and as calm with the journey if it wasn't for those prior conversations with you. So again, thank you for that. Anyway, Kevin, so really, I just want to give the viewers a little bit of context behind yourself, where you've come from, and then we'll sort of just carry on from there as into where you are now. Obviously, the viewers know from our first introduction that you're currently in Spain. So the first sort of aspects of your career from a football perspective, where did they start for you?
Well, I played the game. I played in Guernsey where I grew up. Very, very proud to call Guernsey home. I was actually born in the UK, but I moved there at a very young age. And Guernsey's home for me. I played there up until I moved away to university. And I played at university and then stayed in the UK and had a reasonable career in the non-league game. Played with and against some names I used to watch on television, kind of. Initially had to pinch myself, had a bit of imposter syndrome, not being kind of an XYT or, you know, someone who'd been in the pro game. I'd just kind of come from next to nowhere, really, and really enjoyed, was really lucky to experience a great deal as a player. And then I took kind of the first steps into coaching. I mean, funnily enough, after university, I worked at professional football clubs at Wycombe Wanderers, Northampton Town, Reading and Oxford United with the YTS players at the time, delivering education sessions for them, which was an amazing job for someone who just loves the game. Just started playing post-university, but hadn't quite got up to kind of, you know, the top level of non-league football or step two that was playing at for a few years after that. But it was a really nice balance. And, you know, it was my first kind of step into the world, into the workplace. But it was almost like a kind of purgatory, really, between, you know, the university life and a working life, because I was doing what I loved. I was, and you know, I was a young, very young man, you know, 21 years old. I had an awful lot to learn about life myself, let alone what I was meant to be imparting on the young person.
I'd love to ask, obviously, you know, you were working for four different clubs at that point, four different groups of players. I would love to know, you know, what were some of the differences between those clubs, between those players? Obviously, I guess the wider question that I kind of want to find out really from you is, you know, as well, is what were the differences between those clubs? What did you see? Because I mean, that's quite fascinating to be in four different clubs, to see four different approaches, four different methodologies. I mean, I would love to know about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good question, actually. It's not one that anyone's ever asked me. But when you consider and reflect upon it, there were big differences. So at Oxford United, we had a small group of players, which included two. There was only three players, actually, because it was one particular year group I looked after, and had a small intake in 1 year. And two of those players went on to be highly renowned, you know, players in the Premier League, Dean Whitehead and Sam Ricketts. They were nice lads. They were really nice lads, and the club had a kind of, it was at the old Manor Ground before they moved to the Kasan Stadium, and the education officer there, Mickey Lewis, who's the youth team manager, who went on to be first team manager, would spend a lot of time with us, and was just a really nice, felt like a real family club, to tell you the truth, and the lads were really genuinely nice lads. We had lots of banter, and you know, all the normal stuff was kind of changing room humour that you tend to have. But they were a really nice bunch of lads, whereas I've got to be careful what I say here, but I think the players at some of the other clubs were you know, in their own heads, were you know, a different proposition in terms of, you know, they'd arrived, they were, you know, they weren't respectful of others, quite a lot of them. And yet, I have to say, you know, some of the guys who I thought probably didn't, they lacked let's say the humility. But not, you can expect 16, 17, 18-year-old lads to have the level of humility you would expect later on. But like, football is a great game then. And human values and the importance of communication, of respect for others, of all that kind of stuff. It was still, you know, probably what I was experiencing in the non-league game as I went through. And the differences were more cultural, I would say, rather than structural-wise, because they all had similar programmes, similar training schedules, similar playing kind of philosophies, and it was before ECCC, that might surprise some people. But they had, you know, Kevin Dillon at Reading, for example, and Gary Goodchild at Wickham Wanderers, you know, the two youth team managers, you know, they would go about things very, you know, in a very similar way, I would say, back there. There was a bit of a blueprint, I would say, for bringing new players through, and that was partly about them knowing their place, and them doing all the menial tasks, and you know, it was a school of hard knocks, but from a football perspective, you know, the better ones got to play in the reserve team, and one or two of them even made the first team even back when they were YTs. So some interesting, actually, you know, differences in terms of the clubs. It's not something I've ever reflected on.
I mean, it's interesting, obviously, the way that a lot of coaches, you know, there's a lot more career coaches nowadays looking to try and make it. So just one of the points I just wanted to touch on, and we could talk about that a lot because it's really fascinating for me to try and understand the difference of four different clubs, four different environments, and without putting you too much under pressure to delve more into that one, I really just wanted to touch on, you know, at the time you said you were 21, you were really young, and you were tasked with, you know, educating and helping develop these players. A lot of career coaches are really young, and some of them are really put themselves in fantastic, challenging positions by working with senior teams, with adult teams, with youth teams. What advice would you give those career coaches, or those coaches who are only maybe a couple of years older than the players they're working in? What sort of experiences, what challenges can you remember you having with players who were only a few years younger than you?
Yeah, I think for me, we had to have some common ground. The common ground was that I could play a little bit. So, you know, they saw me. If, you know, there was a balance between the work that we did in the classroom, the work that we would do. I would sometimes take them around the club and we'd do various kind of activities or whatever as part of the curriculum. And then there'd be time when I'd be kicking a ball about with them, or I'd go and play crossbar with a few of the players after the sessions and what have you. And I got a common ground with them. So that's where, and this is a subject we could go way off on in terms of playing, you know, playing experience and how that equates to currency when you become a coach. But But in that instance, it certainly was, and I traded off it, to be perfectly honest. I also would probably say that I was a young leader as well. So I was a leader in dressing rooms. I'd always been to the skippers of teams I played in. And I think I had the confidence to man up, I guess, in front of lads who weren't that much younger than me. They're physically imposing kids as well. Some of them were better made than me. You know, I mean, some of the big boys who came out, the inner city kind of areas of London, they didn't mess about. And if it ever kicked off, let's say, between the players, as it tended to do quite regularly, because there's a lot of testosterone in there. They're all trying to outdo each other, and it was dog eat dog to some extent. I also luckily had the physical presence there and thereabouts to be able to just say, boys, hold them off each other, and and deal with it in a relatively authoritative way. I worked with a lot of teachers that year, a lot of coaches who came in who couldn't deal with that side of things, and they would be more academic in nature, and they wouldn't be able to deal with that. So, I think the advice I would give is that you've got to find some common ground, and you've got to appeal to them. You've got to demonstrate that there's something in it for them, that there's something, whether that's something enjoyable that you can engage on their level on, or obviously if your knowledge is that good that they've got something to gain from you. And I think as you develop as a coach, you understand that, that knowledge starts to come through for players, but perhaps with players in the 16, 17, 18 year old age group, you've got to make an impact first, because if you get on the wrong side and you don't make a good first impression, very, very difficult to win that back.
Yeah, those relationships that you make with those players is vital, I guess. And similar to what you said there, obviously, if you've got a bit of football ability with players of that age, it probably makes a big difference. And without obviously going too far down that pathway, ultimately that can help. I guess the other side of it is those relationships, as you're saying, those relationships that you build with those players is what value can you give to those players. And I think that, like you say, it's a little bit down to each coach to try to work out the value that they have and how they can transfer that to the players to gain that respect. Absolutely. Create that relationship to make it valuable for those players, because ultimately you're probably working with players who are of a much higher ability than you.
Yeah, no. I mean, I think as I developed as a coach and I went through the stages of development as a coach when I stopped playing, I knew I couldn't trade off being, having had a reasonable playing career for too long. In certain instances, it helped me. It definitely helped position me, but that only lasts for so long. And so, how authentic you are, how genuine you are, for me, it's always about how much you're invested in their best interests and how long does it take you to get that message across? How long is it before they realize this guy's here for us? And he's not only is he going to back us, but he's going to challenge us for the betterment of ourselves. And I think in dressing rooms, for years after that, that was something that I was always really, really keen to kind of focus on and make sure that I did everything that I could to make them understood that I care, because I don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And, it's a bit of a cliche, but it's absolutely true.
I mean, just to go back on that, obviously, the thing that really fascinates me is that you were involved in those four different clubs. And what I kind of wanted to just ask just on that relationship thing is, in coaching, this is a huge aspect that we have to do every minute, every second in sessions. It's we have to adapt. And that could be in the form of, okay, we plan for 20 players and all of a sudden 10 turn up or whatever it is happens. And my question to you is, did you have to adapt how you were, how you taught, what you did, how you acted with those different groups of individuals? And what did you have to do? And I guess the final point would be sort of, that sort of adaptability as a coach, how would you define that? How would you sort of give advice to coaches about the importance of being able to adapt? Because I mean, that for me is a hugely fascinating point. I think as coaches, once we've gained a number of years experience And I'm a teacher as well, so I have to do that daily, where you have just so many different situations and you have to adapt all the time. And I think as a coach, especially in that situation there, you probably have to adapt quite a lot, I would imagine.
Yeah, I think the biggest realization, the thing that hit me square between the eyes really quickly, as a young guy just come out of university, expecting, you know, all the preparation I'd done, and to be fair, I wasn't as thorough in my preparation at that age as I was in latter years. But I went in there with expectation that this was going to be very structured. I was going to be able to work through, you know, on a straight line, let's call it. And just as you've kind of alluded to, Simon, very quickly, I was throwing curveballs left, right, and centre. And they were behavioural generally from a group of players who had very little interest and didn't see a benefit in education. Because remember, I wasn't there coaching in football. I was there actually teaching them, you know, helping them to gain academic qualifications to, you know, which, you know, I understood the gravity and the importance of that, because I understood, even if they didn't, the percentage of players that were successful in pursuing a professional football career, and you know, the very small percentage who make it through the YT process, let alone, you know, beyond first, second year pro, and actually make a career where they don't need to fall back on, you know, education and other vocational opportunities. So I had to adapt the length of the lessons. I had to adapt the tasks. I had some who were good learners, and I had some who were horrendous learners. And so I had to set up sessions and set up lessons and teaching environment to adapt to that. So, you know, to keep those who had the attention span of a goldfish, and keep them somehow on the hook, while the others who perhaps, there was one or two more studious lads. I remember a guy called Ben Townsend who played in the FA Cup semi-final for Wickham against Liverpool. And he was a lovely, lovely lad, really nice lad. He was a skipper, and they all respected him, but he was a bit too nice, you know, for some of them who were a lot more hard-nosed at Wickham. And he would be keen to get his work done. He would be keen. He understood the importance. He'd probably had, you know, maybe family or influences who told him, you do this, but only on this premise. Whereas I'd say 70% of the rest of the room was not interested in it. So yeah, I had to, you know, again, you know, get a ball out. They all love the ball, you know, whether they were studious, whether they're not studious, whether they like a certain type of music, or, you know, weren't so bothered about pop culture or whatever it was. They all, the one thing that bound us all together was the ball. And so when we got the ball out, that would be their, you know, it was a bit carrot and stick, to be perfectly honest. And there was, again, it's a long time ago, we're talking 25 years now. But great times, and certainly challenging for a young man as I was at that stage. And I learned a lot, even if I didn't realise it at the time.
Yeah, no, it's fascinating to know, and I appreciate you kind of going into a bit of detail with that. For me, it's great. It's great to hear the challenges that you had, and you know how you managed to overcome some of those, and the advice for coaches on how to deal with some of those challenges. I wanted to try and just move on, if that's possible, and just sort of go over a little bit of some of your experiences with the Guernsey 21s, the senior team, and how those sort of experiences, you know, from before work with some of those players and going to a bit more of a more senior sort of level and an older age groups, how those experiences were for you?
Sure. So I finished playing. I moved back to the Channel Islands the last couple of years of my playing career. Had the great privilege of playing not only for my club, St Martin's, but also for the island or the national team. Something I'd always dreamed of. I'd watched them as a kid. They were my heroes. And although the level of football was probably a backward step from what I'd been playing, you know, in the UK. Certainly in those days, not much. It was there or thereabouts. But I knew I was going back, and I was going to be very capable. And I had a couple of good years as a player there, and then naturally progressed towards when I retired. I had a lot of injuries. I broke my leg the last game I played in the semi-pro game in the UK. I had injuries. The physios and the staff and what have you were strapping me up just to get me out into big games, and it was just becoming a real chore. And Lisa, my wife, and I had our first child, George, on the way. And I took a year out of football, and then I took the opportunity to get involved in a couple of things with Guernsey. Guernsey's under 21s, and also with a new team that had been created at what's effectively step seven in the UK. Step seven in the UK. I traded off my playing career to start off with, no doubt about it. The 21s, some of the players had maybe, one or two of them might have made the debut at senior level when I was around the game, but they all kind of looked up to me, I think, because of my playing career, and I was acutely aware of that. And then I worked with other coaches who were more experienced than me and learned. And then moved to the UK. We moved back to the UK to be nearer to my wife's family. I actually became Guernsey's manager of what you would call a national team, although they're not a FIFA nation. Just almost by circumstance, really. I got a call from the GFA, one of the directors of the GFA, and I was working in the Channel Islands quite regularly for Jersey Telecom. So I was traveling back to the Channel Islands regularly, and I got the call to say, look, the current manager is stepping down, Tony Vance, who's Guernsey FC manager, and this was at the time when Guernsey FC started and went into the pyramid in the UK, and there was some conflict around that, and it was as much, I thought really a temporary kind of, I was the right person, I was respected, maybe both sides of the divide, because there was a bit of a divide at the time, but it was an interesting job, Simon, because I was an inexperienced coach, experienced maybe in the game, experienced in dealing with people, but an inexperienced coach. And it's an interesting study in what whether or not you can actually go and be a manager at a fairly high level, because Guernsey versus Jersey, which is, call it the Marathi, one of the oldest and most famous games in world football. And I say that, and I there's no tongue in cheek about that. It's a huge, huge game to me. Two islands, 65,000, and another 110,000, whatever Jersey's population is. But some top, top players have played in over years. I mean, Graham was so, for example, and many players who played in the professional game and then come back to the islands. And there was a time when both islands basically stopped. Everything stopped. If people didn't travel on the dedicated boats and planes between the islands, they'd listen to it on the radio, or these days, with live streams or whatever. Huge, huge opportunity, huge privilege for me. I was so, so proud to do it, but I was very inexperienced as a coach. The first thing I did was get a great coach to work with me, a guy called Steve Sharman, who, phenomenal, phenomenal coach on the grass, one of the best, if not the best, on the grass I've ever worked with. The kind of guy who, the first time I saw him coach, he looked like he threw a load of paint onto a blank canvas. It was a complete mess. He was like one of those who just uses his hands and rubs it, and gradually you see what he's doing, and by the end of it, you create a masterpiece. But genuinely, that he was and still is an incredible coach. And Steve worked with me, got one or two other people in, really important to get the backroom staff right. And I was good at organising that, good at talking. I think tactically, I probably knew a little bit more than a lot of people in the Channel Islands did. Not everyone, but I felt like I understood the game well enough to win big important games, and I also had the front, I guess, to deal with whatever needed, whether it was media stuff, whether it was political issues, player issues, whatever it was, making difficult selections. But it was a real management job, and it was the absolute embodiment of results based football. There's nothing more important than winning on Marathi Day, Guernsey versus Jersey. So we did training camps, and we'd set it all up, and logistics was phenomenal, absolutely brilliant. And I'd also been to Orland in the Island Games in 2009 as part of Tony Vance's coaching staff. So I'd known the players and had been in and around the environment there. So I'd been able to influence things over a period of time. I think that was 3 years before I did this job. But I'd built my stock to some extent as a player and then as a coach, and then gone back there as the number one. And it was just an amazing experience. But when I look back on it, it was a steering job from a coaching perspective. I set it up the way I wanted to, based on conversations Steve, myself, and Mark Kudzonch, the other coach, and some of the players we had. But once I made my decision, that was it. This is what we're doing, and we did okay. It was a very talented group of players at the start of Guernsey FC's journey. So I was lucky to have a group of players that were largely first that never happened. Guernsey had a team that were playing the English leagues and playing 35, 40 games a season, rather than in the local leagues where they all came together from different teams and it was a lower level of football. So I was definitely lucky to inherit that situation. But it was an amazing experience, something to this day I'm very proud of. And I know, you know, my family, for example, used to take me to watch as a little boy. They probably never expected me to play in it. And I'm pretty certain they definitely never expected me to be the manager in it, especially when I was living in the UK and I didn't even live there. So it was a great job to do for 2 years.
No, I mean, it sounds like a great experience. And I think one really key message that I took out of what you just said there was, although, and this is a really key attribute, I guess, to have as an individual or as a coach going into being a manager or a head coach, is there you saying, you know, you were inexperienced at the time, but you'd realised that you needed to bring in people who were experienced or good coaches in with you, because that was an area that you knew was missing from the team, if you like. And I think that as a skill is really undervalued, actually, because it just shows your level of emotional intelligence, that you know that there are things that you as an individual are missing and you need other people to come on board and pull it together.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, I think that's true, in my opinion, with a technical group, the technical body. I think that's true whether you're Pep Guardiola or whether you're Kevin Graham in your first senior role, because, you know, that first of all, there's a lots of kind of fragmentation of the roles and responsibilities within a technical group now, as you well know. And you can't, no manager can ever do everything, you know, on his own. But I agree with you. It's so important for you to understand your own weaknesses and for you to have a level of humility to be able, and you connect with people, whatever walk of life you're in, or whether, you know, it's business, football, family, whatever it is, but people generally will warm to you if you acknowledge your own weaknesses. And, you know, I probably have got better at that over the years, but I think I was mature enough at that age to understand that was an important decision to make. And, you know, Chris Hammond's goalkeeping coach, Mike Thomas is the head physio. We had an amazing backroom staff of super experienced people. And I was the least experienced guy in there, to be perfectly honest. So, you know, it was an interesting one. And yeah, luckily enough, I think just naturally, hopefully I carry a presence that meant that I could sit there at the front of the room and have a level of credibility with the players, which is the most important thing.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, as you know, and as you've mentioned already before, I think it's, you know, whenever you talk about having success as a coach or even as an individual, it's that understanding of relationships with people, in my opinion, the understanding of relationships with people, how you build those relationships up with people. As we just mentioned there, your understanding of how to bring in other people who are more experienced than you or can cover areas that you are weaker in or you have less experience in. I think those things all together, from what you said there, is extremely vital to ultimately having success and longevity and being able to progress as a coach or a manager or a professional in football.
I agree, absolutely.
Kevin, so I mean, that is fantastic. And I'm conscious that we've still got one really big aspect to go through. So I really just wanted to hand over to you and sort of just walk us through a little bit how you ended up in Spain. What took you to Spain? What took you to here? And then what have you been doing from a football perspective since you've been here?
Sure. So, I mean, just in terms of just filling in the gap between the Guernsey job and moving to Spain, I coached in the UK at a couple of clubs, kind of head of development type roles, which I absolutely loved, and also a first team job And I absolutely loved it, working in the non-league game, and really, you know, really learned how to coach and start to maybe smooth off some of the rough edges. I always went back to beginning, really. I mean, I had a coaching qualification, the old level one, from many, many years back when I was about 20, 21. But I did my level two, started my UEFA B, and worked my way through, you know, an understanding of how to coach younger players, 16, 17, 18 year olds, as well as senior teams. I continued to develop, I guess, as a coach, which never, as a process that never stops. But in 2017, we decided as a family to move to Spain, and purely driven by lifestyle and preferences to give our family the best opportunity and the best opportunity. So my wife and I, we weren't tied to England by our jobs, I certainly wasn't. I work in cloud communications in telecoms, and I generally have a kind of global kind of focus on my job, and have done for many, many years. So it doesn't really matter where I am in the world, as long as I'm near an airport, which is less of an issue these days in terms of, you know, we don't travel as much post COVID. But we're remote working. I've worked remotely since 2010, and anyway, we moved to Spain. We wanted to give the kids the opportunity to learn a different language, to be educated in another language, to be educated culturally in another country. And all of this kind of, you know, occurred. We moved to Malaga, and I started coaching very quickly at Club Deportivo Rincon, which is at the time was a Tercera club. It's dropped down a level below that now, but at the time it was the fourth tier in Spanish football. My son was a talented footballer. He was only aged 8, 9 when we moved here, but he was always on the radar for kind of pro clubs in the UK, and came here and he played for the club. And people started to find out that I had a background in the game, and I started to do some guest sessions with various groups, the juvenil group, the under 19s, the filial team, which is the second team, the reserve team. And to start off with, it was all, you know, a few Spanish words and a lot of English kind of content in there. And then I started to coach a team full time, for the season, just three sessions a week plus a game, which is quite a big commitment. But it really enjoyed working with the Alavin, the infantil age groups, and then finally the Cadete age group, or the under 16s. I had great opportunities to coach, you know, game situations, lots and lots of training, learned an awful lot, and certainly developed my Spanish language skills significantly. I view it as something that helped me to really become a part of the community within which we live, and for our family to do so as well. So football was never the driver, to be honest, Simon. I know there's a lot of coaches who'll be watching this who are perhaps young coaches who are going to go out there and forge a path in coaching, and will do whatever it takes to be a coach. I'm the other way around. There was a time when I, to be honest, it could have gone either way, because I think I've had to turn down a lot of opportunities in football, which at the time I felt like I was hard done to, because, you know, I didn't realise at the time, but actually it was because I was blessed with a young family and all that goes with it. But it felt like a limiting factor for my football at one point. And it's not the case for me. Actually, you know, family and work and what have you has to come first, and football's had to come third. And as a result, football luckily fitted around our life as a family. I learned a lot from a language point of view, as I say, and I had a lot of experience in the game here in terms of working, you know, games around the Malaga region, the Malaga province particularly. We took a team actually to play against the likes of Celtic, Sheffield Wednesday, a few really good teams in the UK. The first time the club had ever taken a junior team across to the UK. Back in, I think it was 2019, I just absolutely loved it. Loved the community side of things. Have to say, I think when you're outside England and you're outside
the environment that used to be so at the heart of, you realise what an incredible footballing nation England is, and what a great job the FA, Jed Roddy, with EPPP and everything that goes with that, the good and the bad, the DNA, the FA DNA projects, the academy system, the coaching culture, the sharing and kind of supportive culture that exists within coaching in England. I think you realise just how good, and one of the reasons why England's age groups throughout the game now, all the way up to obviously Gareth Southgate's England senior team, we're now at the pinnacle of world football. We're now one of the leading nations, and for quite a while there, we absolutely were. And I don't think it's a surprise or a coincidence. So I'm here in Spain, and I don't want to be too critical of this amazing place that's given me so much. But from a football perspective, there's an awful lot that could be improved, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, one thing that I would definitely touch on is I went through the youth awards in England, and the youth modules were absolutely fantastic. They were courses that, in terms of youth development, were fantastic. When we went through the courses, it was all broken down. This is how you can affect the players. This is how you can affect the practices, all of the different types of conditions. Obviously, Ben Bartlett, and the constraints model is a structure and is a model of coaching that I absolutely love. Similar to what you're saying, like when I went through those courses and seeing those delivered in England, I think those courses all came out must be a good sort of 15 years ago, 10, 15 years ago, those courses all came out, and you can now see these players coming through with the style of football that they've got, the understanding. Technically, they've massively improved. Tactically, the players are much better. Physically, as always, we're going to produce good physical players that are very agile, very quick. I think you can see the rewards of that.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. I Ben Bartlett, I could reel off. I'm going to name a few, actually. The likes of Louis Lancaster, for example. From social media perspective, as well as kind of leadership position, Pete Sturgis, Tony Taylor. Yeah. I go back to Dick Bate, for me, the godfather of English coaching. An incredible culture has been created, I think, in the last 15 years, 15, 20 years in England. Michael Beale, incredible. That caliber of individual. He's not the only one. There are so many out there now who are coming through the system. So the coach education system has, and this is right, this is, getting the horse before the cart. Let's make sure that the cart is led by the horse, that the players are led by this fantastic education system, great coach educators, great teachers of the game. I have to say, I only really started to appreciate some of that stuff when I started to coach 10 and 11 year olds over here. I was a fish out of water. So I can take, I could coach in front of thousands or whatever on the sideline in a senior game. But actually, particularly in another language, getting, teaching a kid how to shield a ball, how to protect a ball, how to manipulate the ball. The teaching aspect was something that I only started to connect with when I moved over here 10 years after I'd started coaching. I could speak about that all day long, but I kind of feel very proud of that. I know you had Jack Brazil on the show a couple of episodes ago. Yeah. What a great example.
Jack's smashing it at the moment. Yeah, Jack's absolutely smashing. Well, I mean, Jack just got promoted actually for this coming season. So that is absolute credit to him.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And there wouldn't be those opportunities. His old man has done a fantastic job at Nottingham Forest. And I see he's just got a job in the England setup, which can only benefit our national team and the age groups. But Jack's just a perfect example of what England is producing now in terms of outstanding leaders thought leaders, you know, innovators, and he's out there representing England, you know, on foreign soil, just as you're doing with an incredible club like Atleti. And, you know, I couldn't be prouder when I talk about things like that, because it's very difficult for me to explain and to add the context, the full context, the backstory to where this has all come from. But it all occurred while I was there trying to learn from it all, trying to network, trying to connect with people, trying to just be part of that whole process. And I feel very proud of everyone who has contributed to that, and of England as a nation when it comes to coaching culture particularly.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I mean, I think, you know, similar to yourself, you know, to obviously I know that, you know, you're the main reason that you come out here to Spain was more from a lifestyle perspective, but you still then put yourself in those situations where you're in with a Spanish club, in with Spanish players, learning how to coach. Same as Jack, same as myself, the same as there's other people that are out there doing it as well, which I plan to hopefully get on the channel at some point very soon as well. And, you know, these are the experiences. And I know there's been other British coaches that have worked abroad as well, some extremely famous from many years ago, that have come out and worked, some a bit more recently that have gone abroad and maybe not quite had success, whether that be in Spain or in other countries. We've seen a lot of coaches now going out to Saudi Arabia and stuff like that. And I think the thing that is really, really vital is, you know, similar to what you said before, is understanding how to communicate with people, how to have conversations with people, how to build up relationships with people. And I think you mentioned it somewhere towards the start as well. And it's a case of that cultural aspect, that the language will enable you to better understand the culture that you're going into and adapt to that culture. Without the language, or without having any desire to try and learn the language of the country that you're in, I think your understanding of their culture, their ways, limit you so much. And I think it's very, very difficult to get success without really putting yourself in those situations.
I agree. And you know, I know you from, you know, through an awful lot of hard work, sacrifice, have committed to that. And I think everyone has a different way. So I don't learn out of a book. I never have done, really. I mean, I was academic enough, but I was lucky enough to be able to write and just get through my exams and get the grades I needed. But when it comes to language, I need to be in amongst it. I need to be learning by doing. And that's exactly the platform that football gave me in the local community. And I completely agree with you. I think a big part of coaching at any level is to get the peripheral. All these players have their own circle, their own social circles, their own families, and how they perceive you sometimes will dictate whether you're perceived to be a success or a failure as a coach, because results are one thing, but how you make certainly young players feel and how they reflect upon their experiences with you on the training ground, in the dressing room, in match situations, in social situations years later, sometimes that's the proof in the pudding, because you've then hopefully been one of many influences that's help them on their journey in life. And all of the people around them, when they're young, see what you do and see how you connect. And I've tried to pay that as high a level of attention and respect as I can do. And a lot of that, as you know, and you just described, comes from committing to the language. And I spent my whole life making myself look silly in front of other people. So I've got no problems with trying to speak in the language and making a few mistakes. But I would say that that was actually a limitation. You know, I'm no longer coaching. I haven't coached since the season before the one that's just finished, and I did get very frustrated, particularly because I knew that I could do more. I was, you know, and I've always had that itch that I've never been able to completely get past, whether that's in England or Spain.
But here, the limitation for me, aside from all of the other factors and responsibilities I had, was that final kind of 10-15% of the language that I haven't quite got nailed. So I can speak with anyone one-on-one. But in a high-pressure situation where, let's say, a young kid is kind of almost involuntarily coming out with an awful lot of, you know, they're struggling emotionally with a situation, when you lack that last 10% of the language and that last 10% of the understanding of the local, the colloquialisms, and, you know, the you know, I'm down here in Malaga, right? This is, you try and learn Spanish down here. It's the same to learn.
Yeah, good luck.
It's brutal. It's really brutal. And I it was a frustration that I had, that I knew I'd hit a ceiling. That ceiling was only going to be remedied by me becoming absolutely fluent in the language. And, you know, okay, let's say Carlo Ancelotti goes to a new country and learns his 16th language or whatever he's on at that point. And he can probably, he's in a full-time situation, he's got huge technical staff, he's got, you know, there's a lot of allowances. He doesn't probably need that last 10%. But when you're just part of a technical staff of three or four, working part-time with a group of players three times a week, you desperately need every second counts, and you've got to pay it that respect. And I knew that I'd kind of hit a bit of a ceiling there, because developing young players is an important process, and I felt like I can't do more than I've done.
Yeah, and that's a really, you know, it's a really good realization and a really good self-reflection sort of aspect that you've been able to have for yourself. And, you know, credit to you for being able to reflect on that. And I just want to try and because we're at the end of the time. I really just wanted to just try and get two or three sort of key points from you that you would sort of summarize and give really to coaches or to professionals out there who are looking to progress in the game, whether that be potentially going abroad or whatever it might be. What two or three bits of advice or tips would you give people that are looking to progress in their coaching careers?
Okay, so I'm going to try and say things that are a little bit different to what I hear a lot of the, you know, renowned names in the game kind of promote. First is, back to that point about me coaching young kids, I'm a significantly better coach now than I was when I probably had the highest profile opportunities that I've had in the game. And I think everyone can learn. If you're a senior coach, go and understand what it means to communicate with a group of eight-year-olds. Go and challenge yourself and throw yourself out of your comfort zone. Because if you take one thing from that process and you take that back into the dressing room of first team players, I guarantee you reflect on it and think it's time well spent. So, and I think everyone has time constraints, but I can't stress enough how important I believe that understanding of how to adapt your communication and to adapt the content, the nature of the sessions, the planning of the sessions, all of that, it all equates to experience, right, Simon? And experience is what, in my opinion, it's very rare that you get very young coaches who can do it all. And Jack Brazil is probably an example where I don't know him really, really well. I mean, we've been in touch quite a lot over the years, but I still don't know him as someone who, let's say, I've spent a season coaching with. So I don't know exactly what goes on in the dressing room, but what I know of him, I think he's right up there in terms of his age, and to have that experience. And it is about experience. Again, he's put himself in a situation. It's the same with you. But wouldn't you love to know what someone who's been coaching 25 years knows? So one way to accelerate that, in my opinion, is to put yourself out of your comfort zone. An example would be going and coaching a group of kids. And I can guarantee you there's a lot of Premier League managers who wouldn't have a clue what to do when they went, if they went and actually were tasked with dealing with a group of 7-year-olds. So there's one. Yeah. And then the second one is reiterating the point I made before. I think every player has a circle of influence around them. And I think to get the best out of individuals, luckily we're a lot more people-centric as coaches now, I think. And I think the likes of Michael Beale, for example, you know, Carlo Ancelotti, his beacon in his coaching journey. These are people whose values, human values and ability to connect with others, that's really at the fore now. And so where it used to be about X's and O's and session plans and what have you. Of course, that's critically important, but more important is how do you understand the player? And actually, you've got to understand what's around them, and you've got to connect with the parents. You've got to connect with, you know, perhaps the school teacher. You've got to connect with their brother and sister. Try and understand and try and take the time just to understand a little bit more about what's around them for you then to be able to connect with them on the training ground, the dressing room.
Yeah. No, fantastic. Like, just really, really good, honest points. I think, you know, you always need in those sort of situations, and I think it massively helps when you've got examples of people that you can use, and some of the examples of people you've given. Obviously, Jack is a really, really important and current one, who I would say, you know, he's really in a really good position, really good club, really seems to be progressing really well. And, you know, similar to what you're saying, when you put yourself in those situations of challenge and you take yourself out of your comfort zone, that is where you're really going to learn a lot about yourself. You're going to learn how you deal with really difficult situations and scenarios, and ultimately it makes you as a person much stronger. Your experiences are so much more deeper, and especially when it's abroad, it just amplifies it so much. And, you know, you don't even need to know. Like, I've had conversations with Jack and yourself and other people that have been in positions abroad, and you don't even need to ask a question, because you know, as a fellow professional, that, you know, in a similar sort of situation, you know exactly what that person would have gone through to get to that situation. And I know, talking to Jack and yourself, you know, even for me, there are times where I've come home and I'm like, this is tough. This is really, really tough. And you do question. You do question your resolve. You question your mental strength. There are some days, similar to what Jack said in the previous episode, you know, there are times where you just wonder whether or not you just pack up and you go home. But ultimately, there's a reason why you end up in that position in the first place. And you just go, do you know what? I've come so far. I'm just going to go for it. I'm just going to keep going, and whatever happens, happens. And, you know, if everything goes peak-tong and it goes pear-shaped, you know what? For most people, for most young coaches out there, they can probably go, do you know what? My parents are back home. I can just go back if all else fails and I start again. And it's actually probably not too bad. You can start again. You've gained all those experiences, and you will end up being a better person for it. So I think, you know, 100% what you've just summarized there, for me, I would totally agree. And, you know, for the coaches and stuff watching, those points that you've said, for me would be vital.
Yeah. I mean, look, you're already winning. If you've got out there, you're in that process, you've already won. Actually, you have already won, because you are learning, and you have added layers to your experience in life that are invaluable, and 0.01% of coaches are going to experience. So by making the commitment and all of those hard nights and all those times when you wonder, is it really worth it? You know, there are trade-offs, because some of the highs I've had in Spanish football with dressing rooms of Spanish players have been off the scale, off the chart, in terms of, you know, some of the happiest memories that I've got in life, not just football. And when I see them in the street, and when I see their parents, and I see, you know, directors at the club or whatever, and I stop and talk to them today, believe you me, I realise how important football and coaching football has been in you know, in making my life a happier place.
Yeah. Well, Kevin, thank you so much for your time. Really interesting story, and some of the points and some of the advice that you've given for coaches has been fantastic. So thank you so much for your advice, your time. I just urge the viewers to hit the subscribe button. Can they get in contact with you if they want to ask you any more questions? I mean, I can tag you in the post on Twitter and stuff.
Yeah, by all means, yeah. Just stick my handle on there, Webley Ed. That's the handle. I'm not quite as active on Twitter as I used to be, but by all means, if anyone wants to reach out and has any questions about my journey or anything, they think I can help in any way, I'm more than happy to. And thank you for asking me on here. It's been really enjoyable speaking to you, mate. It's been a while since we've spoken, and I watch everything that you do, and I'm just super impressed by your commitment to the journey that you're on. And I'm so happy for you. I'm so happy that you're getting the success that you deserve. So, thanks. Thanks to you.
No, I appreciate it, Kevin. And again, thank you for your support over my journey, and thank you for the kind words. And yeah, we'll see where we go. No, it's all a journey. It's all a learning experience. And these are the things that ultimately make us stronger. So it is all in the name of coaching, education, and trying to make ourselves better, which ultimately is what we're here for. So, Kevin, thank you. Thank you very much for your time. It's been great to have you on. Absolute pleasure. Enjoy a few coppers on the beach this week. Enjoy the weather. And yeah, look forward to catching up with you soon.
I'll do my best. No one's going to have any sympathy for me if I said that it's been really hot down here this summer, and it's a grueling process. No one has any sympathy with me, so I'm not going to start now. Yeah, you're right. I'm lucky enough to be able to pop down and have a drink by the beach. So I'll take your advice and do just that.
Yeah, no. Well, I will shout you a beer for sure one day when I'm down in Malaga. So yeah, Kevin, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Hasta luego.
Oh,
see you later.
Adiós.
Ciao.